Alors, vous les deux là.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, for the opportunity to contribute to the debate in which the Honorable House has been asked to approve the financial policy of the Government of Ghana for the year ending 31st December 2019. And in doing that, Mr. Speaker, even though I would want to talk on energy, it is important that since this is a House of Records, yesterday the Minister for Education got up on a point of order in which he indicated that you did not need to produce your TIN number before you access some social services, for example, the National Health Hospital and then the free SHS. And I just want to read what the budget indicated. On the basis of that, we use that as a record. Mr. Speaker, with your permission, on paragraph 297, page 70, he indicated, Mr. Speaker, the Revenue Administration Act 2016 lists many services and transactions that cannot be assessed by individuals without TIN. Unfortunately, compliance with these requirements have been low. In 2019, we will begin to apply sanctions to state and private entities that fail to enforce these TIN requirements. Additionally, government in providing social services and benefits provided by the state will require beneficiaries or their guardians to have a TIN. This will complement the current efforts by the GRA and to get more persons and businesses on their radar. And Mr. Speaker, on 310, the minister indicates that, Mr. Speaker, government will then broaden the tax net by simplifying payments of tax through different routes under the guidance of the GRA, include the elimination of paying for government services with cash, requiring that citizens show their TIN before accessing social services like free health care under the National Health Insurance Program, free secondary school education under the free SHS program beginning in September 2019, and other services like vehicle licensing and registration, passport services, banking service, as well as mobile money services. Mr. Speaker, I am so disappointed that for a minister who is the head of a sector, he didn't even know what he had provided for in his own ministry. And in parliament, he came on a point of order to indicate that you did not need to produce your TIN number to access social services. This is a disappointment. This is something that the Minister for Education must come back to this House to be able to apologize. Having said that, Mr. Speaker, I believe that in debating the 2019 budget, it is important to make an assessment of what we have done in 2018. I remember when the minister came in 2017 November to this House, he had indicated that, among other things, they were targeting to reduce electricity tariffs across various customer categories. Two, they wanted to enhance the petroleum legal framework to deepen transparency and predictability in contracting and operations. Three, that they wanted to use financial products as part of the petroleum price risk management program to hedge the country's exposure to crude oil price fluctuations. Four, they wanted to build renewable energy capacity through a program they called Government Goes Solar to reduce government's expenditure on utilities. And the fifth one, they said they wanted to roll out the National LPG Promotion Policy and the implementation of the cylinder recirculation model. Mr. Speaker, of all these that they listed, they just dealt with only one. And that had to do with the issue of reduction in tariffs. But even with that, it came with its own problems. Mr. Speaker, you recall that in last year's debate, we drew the attention of the minister to the fact that it was important and it was very good to reduce tariffs. But where they were targeting was very dangerous. We had advised them to look at the fiscal regime that covered tariffs, but they rather went for the energy charges. And today, because of that, what they have effectively done is to encroach on the revenue requirements of the utilities. As we speak today, the total indebtedness of that sector, I'm talking about the power subsector, from May 2017 to October ending 2018, is almost a billion. Indeed, ECG can only honor 20% of its receipts. As we speak, ECG owes Car Power 300 million Ghana cedis. Mr. Speaker, if you have a situation where even utilities cannot raise the required resources to be able to run their generating plants, it is very clear that whether you like it or not, they will have problems with fuel, and therefore you can have those erratic power supply that we have been experiencing in the past 1 week. Mr. Speaker, now in 2019 budget, just like in 2018 budget, one area the budget has been very silent on is on our thermal oil refinery. Indeed, the budget has not been able to tell us what is the future of this refinery, how we are going to sustain it. Is there a possibility that we can make it profitable? And to a very large extent, what is the key role it will have to play in fuel security in Ghana? I say this on the basis of the fact that just a few weeks ago, the ministry decided to underwrite a guarantee for TOR to procure crude oil to a level of around 250,000 barrels of crude. Whilst at the same time, the minister, that's the former minister, goes on air to indicate that they were converting our premier refinery into a tank farm. The question then is, what is the policy direction of this particular ministry? What is the policy direction of government? There are a few questions I think we need to ask. One, does the ministry, or for that matter, government, intend to continuously guarantee for TOR to procure crude? Two, if yes, how does TOR benefit from economies of scale? Because as we speak now, they produce, in terms of refinery, they just refine just around 28,000 barrels of crude. Indeed, if you want to break even for any average refinery, you need to process not less than 70,000 barrels of crude in a day. So if you are processing 28,000, what you are simply doing is that you are definitely running down that particular facility to a halt. So the question is, what is the strategy of government? We need some clarity in that area. Mr. Speaker, the other point I will want to deal with has to do with the fact of rural electrification. As we speak today, if you look at the 2016 budget, capital expenditure as a ratio of GDP was 4.5%. In 2017, it was 3.1. In 2018, it came to 1.7. It simply tells you that, irrespective of the size of our GDP, the amount of money we invest in public infrastructure is going down. So it is not surprising, Mr. Speaker, that as we speak, in 2017, the minister had promised that in 2018, we were going to connect communities, 2,185 communities. We just did 285. This year, the minister promised that we're going to connect 1,760. They just did 122, about 6.7% of their target. It explains why government has decided to move its target of universal access to electricity from 2020 to 2030.
Yeah, can one you... more minute.
The time has just gone so fast. It tells you very clearly that this is a government that has just decided not to invest in the energy sector. If we are not careful, Mr. Speaker, as we speak, very soon, most of us who come from rural communities, most of us who are MPs in rural communities, our people will have to wait for the next 12 years to have access to electricity. And that's a terrible thing that we will have to be enduring. I just pray and hope that as a country, we will take a second look and understand that the service that we are rendering to this country is not because of our pockets, it's not because of our own well-being, but it's because of the fact that we want to ensure that every Ghanaian breaks away from the shackles of poverty. On this basis, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, for the opportunity. Yeah.